I don't think I mentioned this before, but back in 1995 to around 1997, I actually owned a pair of Neat speakers. I just moved back to London from my university days in Cardiff, and I was living in one of those shared houses, you know, the type where you have all your contents in one room, glorified bedsit in a way, still pretty much living like a student, but with two key differences. Instead of going to university, I was going to work, and because I was going to work, I had more disposable income. And this is well before I had the responsibilities of owning a property and raising a family. So naturally, that disposable income went on hi-fi. I wasn't completely reckless though. I used to buy ex-demo or used. I'd purchased a second-hand pair of ProAc Talisman 3s pretty much because I'd fallen in love with the looks. That beautiful wood finish along the front baffle, which was angled backwards. But I never got a chance to work out whether the lack of resolution I experienced from that speaker was down to the speaker itself or some other matching issue in my system. That's also the time period where I acquired the Arcam Delta 290 amplifier, which I think was actually an ex-demo unit rather than second-hand. But regardless, I really enjoyed that amplifier, as I mentioned in my recent review of the Naim Nait 5 SI amplifier and matching CD player. The upgrade itch got the better of me and I traded in the Arcam for a second-hand Oral SC100 preamplifier and its matching SP100 power amplifier. Even though technically the Oral was better than the Arcam, I always missed that old Arcam for its rich tonal character. I suppose back then I was still trying to figure out the sound that I was looking for. In fact, Oral is an interesting company. It's a small outfit that's long since gone now, but back then they had quite a bit of expertise in certain areas. And I know they did some work for other manufacturers behind the scenes. For example, they were involved in developing the first CD player for Exposure alongside John Farlow. And I think they had strong links to Musical Fidelity. Perhaps Anthony Michelson, the founder of Musical Fidelity, was involved somehow. In any case, I'm digressing. Back to the Neats. I bought a used pair of the original Neat Petite speakers that I thought had very good clarity, but couldn't bend the laws of physics. They produced little to no bass, and always felt that they had a slightly thin mid-range for my personal taste, but I still liked them for near-field listening. That entire system disappeared one weekend. In fact, I came back from a weekend away to find out that I'd been robbed. They took my hi-fi, they took my TV, they even took my clothes for Pete's sakes. I mean, who takes your clothes? But in any case, it didn't take me too long before I started to replace stuff. The Neat Petite speaker was the first speaker that Bob Sergino designed when he launched the company, and it went through various incarnations through the years. It was eventually killed off in 2016, but to celebrate their 30th birthday in 2021, Bob brought it back with the Neat Petite 30. Similar in dimension to the original Petite, but a completely different design featuring an air motion transformer tweeter. There are only 100 pairs of this special edition Petite 30 made for the worldwide market, and it came with a USB stick containing some of Bob's favourite music, a tote bag, as well as a premium gloss finish. That speaker was so well received by the people who got to review it, as well as the people who got to own it. The feedback was so positive that Bob decided it's time to bring the Neat Petite back. Now, the speaker that I'm reviewing is called the Classic, and it isn't exactly the same as the 30th anniversary model. Gone is the gloss finish, and sadly you don't get Bob's USB stick with his favourite recordings. And there's also a couple of tweaks that have happened. He's made some changes to the crossover design, as well as got rid of the by-wire speaker binding posts, but essentially this is the same speaker. So I had to find out what all the fuss was about. The Neat Petite Classic measures 30 by 20 by 18 centimetres, which is 11.8 by 7.9 by 7.1 inches. Each speaker weighs 7.5 kilograms or 16.5 pounds. If the textured black finish isn't to your liking, there's also a satin white finish available, but there are no other colours or wood finishes available at present. A stereo pair will set you back £1,995 in the UK. It's a two-way design with cabinets made in Britain. The 150mm 6-inch SB acoustic mid-woofer deploys a mineral-filled polypropylene cone. It hands over duties at 3800Hz to a Dayton Audio AMT or Air Motion Transformer tweeter, which has a felt surround to assist with edge diffraction issues. On the rear you'll find one set of speaker binding posts which I have to say are below par for a speaker at this price. They're fine with banana plugs, but with spades are too diminutive to sustain any reasonable contact pressure. The twin port arrangement is a little unusual for a speaker at this price. More on that coming up later. Foam plugs are provided to accommodate those looking for close to wall placement. There's nothing particularly unusual that I can find about the midwoofer. It's 150mm or 6-inch polypropylene cone doped with minerals from SB Acoustics. That's a Danish firm, and if I'm not mistaken, I think they're former ScanSpeak employees. In any case, their drivers are found in a number of modern speakers, including those from Bukart Audio. Mads Bukart has a very close working relationship with the guys at SB Acoustics. The AMT tweeter, that's a little bit more unusual, especially in a two-way design. AMT tweeters are normally found in three-way designs, and that's because they don't play particularly low. And that's one of the reasons why the crossover point on this speaker is at 3,800 Hz. Normally you expect it to be around 2,000 Hz on a two-way design. But there are pluses and minuses to an AMT tweeter, and let's talk a little bit about that. A conventional soft or metal dome tweeter features a diaphragm. A voice coil is wound around the base. A ring magnet is placed around the coil. An electric current passes through the voice coil. Due to the interaction of the two magnetic fields, the voice coil, and hence the diaphragm, moves, as is consistent with Michael Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. The benefits of a dome tweeter are that they're pretty inexpensive to manufacture, and due to their small size, have a wide dispersion in all directions. If the cone material is stiff enough and well damped, they can produce low distortion. Also, compared to other tweeter designs, a dome tweeter will play relatively low and offer good power handling. It is worth noting that a pure ribbon tweeter is different to an AMT design. In a pure ribbon, a metal film, usually made out of aluminium, is suspended between two strong magnets. It's secured at the top and the bottom, but free to move in the middle. A transformer is needed because the ribbon has such low impedance. Now I'm going to oversimplify that and ask you to consider it simply as AC resistance. Again, by the principles of electromagnetic induction, the electrical signal from the amplifier, which energizes the primary coil in the transformer, is transferred to the secondary coil of the transformer, which is connected to the ribbon. As with the voice coil earlier, because the ribbon is placed within a permanent magnetic field, it will move when electric current passes through it. The benefit of ribbon tweeters are that because they have such low moving mass, they have an excellent transient response. They also play extremely high, with some designs extending beyond 50,000 Hz. You won't be able to hear that high, but they offer great dynamic headroom. Ribbon tweeters are also more expensive to manufacture. They don't play as low as a dome. That's why you tend to find them more often on three-way designs than two-way designs. Also, they have good lateral dispersion, but not so much in the horizontal plane. So getting the tweeter to ear height becomes more critical. An air motion transformer or AMT tweeter has a pleated shape similar to bellows. It can be a folded pure ribbon, but usually a metal trace is etched to a thin layer of PET, polyethylene terephthalate. Strong magnets are placed behind the folded diaphragm, generally neodymium. As the signal passes through the trace, it changes direction by 180 degrees in accordance with the folds, causing the diaphragm to squeeze in and out like an accordion, pushing sound waves out towards the listener. Because of the folded geometry, AMT drivers have a very large surface area, which means they're very efficient and can offer low distortion due to not having to work as hard as a pistonic driver. The extra moving mass of the PET film means that they don't quite have the transient response of a pure ribbon, but are still lighter and faster than a dome driver. Similarities they share with ribbon drivers are that they're more expensive to build, don't play as low as a dome, and have a narrow dispersion, especially vertically, so can present some challenges to integrate with cone drivers, which are likely to be taking care of frequencies further down. The crossover is worth mentioning, although I haven't got a picture of the network itself to show you. It's reputed to use very good quality parts, air core inductors, polypropylene capacitors, high quality resistors, and it's a minimalist design, just a first order filter on the midwoofer and a second order filter on the tweeter. The benefit of using good quality parts and as few of them as possible is that the crossover network itself should place very little degradation on the signal in terms of distortion and time smearing. The downside is that you're placing a lot more demand on the drivers themselves. You've got more gentle slopes with lower order crossovers, so there's more bleed through from one driver to the other, which means that they need to be matched very carefully. And also, because they've got a gentler slope, there's more chance of breakup nodes outside the normal band of operation of the driver becoming audible, as everything with speaker design. It's all a compromise. The other thing that's quite interesting about the Petite Classics is the twin port arrangement at the back. With the smaller port tuned at 35 Hz with a low Q, that means that it's heavily damped, operating over a narrow band of frequencies. The larger port has a higher Q and operates over a wider range of frequencies centered around 70 Hz. Whether you want both foam plugs taken out or the bottom one taken out will depend on how much bass you want and the position of the speakers in the room, something I'll talk about in more detail in the setup section. I like to think that I'm the kind of guy that has my feet placed firmly on the ground, but even then, there's aspects of the performance of the Neat Petite Classics that I find staggering. For starters, the clarity. I don't think I've heard another speaker below £3,000 that has the ability to retain as much information of a recording as these little petites. It's better than my ProAc Response 1SEs in this regard, and I have to say, even though the 80Cs went back a long time ago, I think it's better than the SCM19s as well. It's highly unusual for a ported design speaker to have this degree of articulation in the bass. That's normally the preserve of well-designed seal box type enclosures. And it just goes to show how well implemented that dual port arrangement is in the Petite Classic for the transient response to be this good. That clean transient response translates to the mid-range as well, where yet again, the Petite Classics just edge out my ProAc Response 1SEs in terms of clarity, if only just. The leading edges of notes are just a little bit crisper, and it's just a bit easier to follow individual instruments in the mix, although the difference isn't that great. But here, the Petite Classics don't have everything their own way. The ProAcs have a lot fuller, a lot more acoustic mass to their presentation. I won't go as far as to say that the Petite Classic sounds lean. You could make an argument for saying that it's the more neutral speaker, but those of you looking for that more classic British monitor sound with a full mid-range, it certainly isn't that. That AMT tweeter is super detailed, extended, fast and refined, but it does run a little bit hot. So if you've got any harshness in the recording or in your partnering equipment, it's going to take no prisoners. Here yet again, the information on offer is exemplary. So well are the upper harmonic structures of notes preserved and the timing information captured that, if set up correctly, the Petite Classics are capable of producing the most stable stereo image I've heard in my room since I started reviewing on this channel. Now, that isn't a trivial thing to say, because my own ProAc Response 1SEs are known for their sound staging and imaging capability, but everything, every instrument, is just a little bit more secure in its location with the Petite Classics. As far as sound staging is concerned, well, that's where the ProAcs still shine. They offer a more immersive soundstage, it's wider and deeper, but I don't think anyone's going to find anything to complain about when it comes to the little Neats in this regard either. The only other speaker that I had to hand that's worth mentioning in the same sentence as the Petite Classics is the excellent DALI Menuet SEs. They're a much smaller speaker, more suited towards near-field listening. Over time, I've come to regard those as a scaled-down version of my ProAcs, primarily because they have a very similar tonality. They're very resolving, and they have that richness in the mid-range which I particularly enjoy, even if they aren't quite as open as my 1SEs. And they're a smaller speaker, so they're limited in terms of bass and dynamics. And in terms of bass dynamics as well as clarity, they certainly feel a class below the Petite Classics. At superficial glance, the Neat Petite Classics seem to offer quite a bit of flexibility when it comes to speaker positioning. You can certainly shove two port bungs in the back of each speaker and place them closer to walls. And in that particular setup and arrangement, they will mirror the response of a seal box enclosure, rolling the bass off earlier with a more gradual response. But in my opinion, you're losing half the performance of the speaker in that setup. All that subtle detail, clarity and timing information that I was talking about earlier, Well, most of that's gone with the speaker so close to the wall and the time smearing effect that that brings. I had them about a meter, that's just over 3 feet into the room, with the bottom bung taken out. With both bungs taken out, I found them a bit too bass heavy for my room, but your mileage may vary. I also had my stands raised to 70 centimeters, that's about 27 inches, so the tweeters were ear height, and in the classic toe-in position with the tweeters just pointing past my shoulders at each side. These Petite Classics are very revealing speakers. It's not going to be forgiving of poor recordings or poor partnering equipment, so stick to good quality, price appropriate gear. The tweeter does tend to run a little bit hot, so I wouldn't partner it with anything that's overly bright. As long as you stick to those particular rules, it's quite free of coloration and it should work with a wide range of amplifiers. I was off to a good start with the Petite Classics because the first amplifier hooked up was a Naim Nait 5SI. Naim and Neat are a pairing that traditionally work well together, and I can see why, because all the pace, rhythm and timing that Naim is known for was clearly on display. But ultimately, 5SI's limitations in terms of sound staging meant that it wasn't able to get the best out of these speakers. The soundstage opened up considerably in terms of width and depth when I switched to the Exposure 2510. The Exposure also has a little bit more extension on top, which meant that the Neats were able to resolve more detail. But for all the virtues of that amplifier, it does trade a little bit of that toe-tappy, snappy bass with the Nait 5. That's still very much a Naim thing. Swapping to the Willsenton R8 with upgraded PS Vane tubes, I got all the bass weight that I could desire, even though it wasn't the last word in definition. Now, I wouldn't describe the Naim as being lean in the mid-range, and certainly not the Exposure, but with both of those amplifiers, the Neats could exhibit some reticence with lead vocals and lead instruments. Not a hint of it with the Willsenton, because it's such a warm, rich sounding amplifier. Now, it's quite refined in the upper regions given its price, but so revealing are the Neats that they did unearth some hardness in the upper mid-range, which I'm sure could be ironed out with even better quality tubes. There are going to be people out there who are going to think it's overkill partnering what would be today 5 grand's worth of amplifier with 2 grand's worth of speaker, but I'm not one of them. It just showed how well the Petite Classics were able to scale up. It may not be the traditional British sound that I'm used to, but the sheer clarity, refinement, and the scale and precision of the sound laid out in front of me was highly entertaining. The Neat Petite Classics have the ability to unearth astonishing levels of detail within a recording. You just have to make sure that your source material and the rest of your equipment are up to the job. And it manages to do this without sounding dry and analytical in the process, partly because it's so dynamic and engaging to listen to. Okay, so the relatively plain clothing might not be everybody's cup of tea, and I'd personally like to see some more finish options. Also, those of you looking for a traditional British monitor sound will probably choose another speaker with more harmonic richness. But the blend of qualities that are on offer here are truly exceptional for the price, and I think the Neat Petite Classic is going to win over many fans. Who knows, 30 years from now, it may be even considered a classic, not only just in name, but also in reputation in its own right. I'm highly impressed with what's on offer here. The Neat Petite Classic gets an outstanding from this channel. It's nice to know that Neat, some 30 plus years down the line, is still going strong, but there's other brands like Orel that I mentioned earlier in this video that no longer exist today. And it's about those kind of brands that had interesting and promising products, but for whatever reason don't exist today, that I'd like to hear in the comments section. I think it'll make for a really interesting discussion and perhaps even help people pick out some gems on the used market. All that remains for me to say is, if you like this video, if you like what I'm doing on this channel, you want to see it grow and you haven't done so already, please do all that social media stuff. Check me out on Patreon for consultancy services, bonus content, join the ABA club where we have periodic video calls. But for today, for now, a British audiophile signing off.